the way she was dancing.
So much for being with us, as well as those that are joining us online. We trust the service will be a blessing to you. If you're here with us for the very first time, I'm going to ask if you would, there is a contact card in the pew in front of you. If you would, fill that out and drop it in the offering plate as you leave. Or the other option is there is a QR code in your bulletin, and you can just scan your phone over that, and it'll take you directly to a place where you can fill that contact card out online, and we would greatly appreciate that. I want to encourage you to read your bulletin so you don't miss out on the many things that are going on. Of course, Wednesday evening at 6:30, our Wednesday evening Bible study, both in the fellowship hall and online, and I encourage you to join us for that as Pastor Steve continues his verse-by-verse study through the book of James. And then there's an announcement on the back of your bulletin regarding Vacation Bible School, which starts on July the 11th. And at this time, if you would direct your attention to this screen, we're going to have a video about Vacation Bible School.
Are you ready for the most epic adventure ever? Group VBS is taking kids on a ride they'll never forget. Get on board the Rocky Railway.
Good morning. So good to see you here. Let's stand up and sing to our Lord and Savior together this morning.
Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one.
Let's go, Lord, in prayer here this morning. Father in heaven, thank you so very much for this day that you have given to us to gather together to worship you because you alone are worthy. Thank you, Father, for every blessing that we have been given in Christ Jesus. That everything that we need for life and for godliness is found in Christ. That we are accepted before you because of Christ. And it's our prayer this morning that the name of Jesus be lifted up in this place. Lord God, I pray that you would meet the needs that are represented in this place this morning. Wherever individuals are at as they come into this building or watch online, in their relationship to you, I pray, Father God, that your will be done. If there is one or more who doesn't know Christ as Savior, I pray that today would be the day they repent of their sins and turn to you for salvation. For Christians here this morning who are struggling and battling and feeling wayward, I pray that you would encourage and draw them back to yourself. Lord God, I pray you'll be with Pastor Steve as he opens up your word, that our hearts and our minds would be open and receptive to that which you've given to him to share with us from your word, and that it might bring forth abundant fruit in our lives. Again, Lord God, thank you for this day. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your faithfulness. And we pray all this in the name of Jesus for his sake. Amen.
Let's read a responsive reading together. If you'll turn to hymn number 670 in your hymnal, you'll be reading the bold text. And I encourage you to really, instead of just passively reading this and speaking this out, I encourage you to really think about what it means to you and profess this truth together. So let's stand up. Number 670. O Lord, you have searched me and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise, you perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you know it completely, O Lord. You hem me in, behind and before. You have laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Amen. While you're standing, we're going to be singing the song of the month, Yes, I Will. So I encourage you to sing that along with us this morning.
Yeah. Amen. Thank you so much. If you would open your Bibles this morning to the book of Luke, and we're going to be in chapter 12. Chapter 12, in just a moment, beginning in verse 40. Luke chapter 12, verse 40. When I was in high school, one of the popular things was to go down to the beach at graduation. All the kids seemed to go down there. I will tell you that my idea of going to the beach at graduation was, at that time, was going in the ocean, riding waves, body surfing, looking at girls. I mean, you know, those kinds of things, but not the partying stuff. And everybody wanted to go. Well, my sophomore year, my buddies were begging me, let's go to the beach during graduation week. And so I begged my parents, and I'd never given my parents any reason not to trust me. And they debated about it, and then they decided they were going to let me go. So we got a hotel room, decided we were going to go. And then to top it all off, my dad told me, he said, would you like to take my 65 Mustang convertible with you? Now, I owned a 65 Mustang. I still own 65 Mustang. It was a hard top, but Dad had a, if you can remember, Ryder truck. It was Ryder truck yellow with a black top, convertible, three-speed in the floor, high-performance engine with sweet-sounding mufflers. This car was like, it was it. I'm telling you, it was it. And I'm thinking, driving this thing up and down the Myrtle Beach Strand? Yes, Daddy, I'll take your car. But I was a nervous wreck about making sure nothing happened to that car. And I remember we were up on the balcony of our hotel. The parking lot for the hotel was across the street. And you had to park with put a little pass in your dash, on your dash, that said that you were staying at the hotel. And so I put it in there. Problem is, it was a hot, hot day. We knew we were going to be riding in it that afternoon. So we left the top down on it. Well, we were standing up on the balcony, and my friend looks over at the parking lot, and he looked at me, and he says, why is your Mustang slanted up like that? And we looked over there, and it was up on a tow truck. And I was 16 years old at the time. So at 16 years old, I went down 8 flights of stairs, across the road, through traffic, into a parking lot. I think I did it in 6 seconds flat. And darted across there, barely missed cars weaving in and out through the traffic to get over to the car, got to the tow truck. I said, what are you doing? He said, I'm towing it away. It doesn't have a parking pass. And I explained what had happened. Somebody had stolen the parking pass out of the dash area, and they were towing that truck away. And you might say, well, why all the panic? Why frantically run down all those flights of stairs? Why dart across traffic? Why get through all of that stuff and risk your life to get your car off a tow truck? Because I was thinking to myself what my daddy would do if that car got put in a tow place somewhere and I had to go get it out. The reality of it is, all the panic was because my dad had entrusted his car to me, and I knew I was responsible for it. I want you to think about what all God has entrusted to us, what God has given to you and to me to do while he's away, while Jesus is gone away, until the time that he returns. Think about what he's entrusted to us. What's he called us to do? How has he called us to live our lives? And how concerned are we about it? How concerned are we about the fact that God has given us something to use and to work with and a mission to carry out? How concerned about that are we? How much of our time, how much of our talents, how much of our money, how much of all that we have is being poured into carrying out the wishes of our Father in heaven while we wait on Jesus? Now, I want you to think about that for your own personal life today. I want you to think about, what are you doing with the resources that God has given you, your time, your talents, and your treasures? If you are able to stand with me as we read from chapter 12 of Luke, we're going to read Luke 12, 40 through 48. We're reminded that all Scripture is inspired by God. It's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. And this is why we always open God's word. Listen to what it says in verse 40. Therefore, you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. Then Peter said to him, Lord, do you speak this parable only to us or to all people? And the Lord said, who then is that faithful and wise steward whom his master will make ruler over his household to give them their portion of food in due season? Blessed is that servant whom his master will find so doing when he comes. Truly I say to you that he will make him ruler over all that he has. But if that servant says in his heart, my master is delaying his coming, and begins to beat the male and female servants and to eat and drink and be drunk, the master of that servant will come on a day when he's not looking for him and at an hour when he is not aware, and will cut him in two and appoint him his portion with the unbelievers. And that servant who knew his master's will and did not prepare himself or do according to his will shall be beaten with many stripes. But he who did not know yet committed things deserving of stripes shall be beaten with few. For everyone to whom much is given, from him much will be required. And to whom much has been committed, of him they will ask the more. You can be seated. As we go into this passage of Scripture this morning, the main idea I want you to take away is be ready for the return of the Lord. This is the same main idea that we had in last week's passage. If you're a guest or joining us for the first time in a few weeks, we have been going through a little mini series. We went through a series on fear. We ended that series talking about the fear of the future. And then we were looking at worry in chapter 12, verse 22 through 34. And then we went into last Sunday talking about being prepared for the return of the Lord and our future when He comes back. We talked there in verse 35 about being focused on the work of the Lord, and we talked about being faithful as a witness for the Lord. And then we also talked about be found watching for the Lord. And then coming right out of that, because he's still in the same story, Peter begins to ask these questions about this parable that Jesus has just spoken. So he asks him a question. And that's where we dig into this text today. But the main idea from last week and today are both tied together with verse 40. Therefore, you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. Two truths I want you to consider this morning in regard to that. And the first is this: faithfulness is rewarded. Faithfulness is rewarded. So as we look at this together and we get into verse 40, I said that be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. But then Peter in verse 41 said to him, Lord, do you speak this parable only to us or to all people? Now let's back up just for a moment to last week's passage, because verse 35 is a direct command, let your waist be girded. Verse 35 also another command, let your lamps be burning. But then in verse 36, he starts this parable where he says, and you yourselves be like these men who were found watching, who were waiting and ready. That's the parable that Peter is asking about in verse 41. So he says, Lord, do you speak this parable only to us, or do you speak this to all people? Now, the scholars debate about who is he talking about here? Do you speak it only to us 12? Do you speak it only to us disciples? Or do you speak it to all? Do you speak it to all of us who are leaders? Do you speak it to all of us 12? Do you speak it to all of us who are disciples of Christ? Or do you speak it to everybody completely? This is the question that Peter asks. And scholars debate about the meaning of that. Jesus doesn't answer the question. He doesn't say, Peter, I'm talking to all people, or Peter, I'm talking to just you 12. He never answers the question. He then goes into another parable here and talking about the Lord said, who then is that faithful and wise steward? He gives us an analogy here of a faithful steward. And it's implied here that the faithful steward is the one who's ready for the return of the Lord. The faithful steward is the one who is found watching. The faithful steward is the one who's girded up his waist, got his lamps burning from verse 35, and found watching and waiting for his master when he returns. It's the faithful steward. So he says, who then is that faithful and wise steward? Now let's talk about a steward for just a moment. A steward was someone in that day who was put over the household to watch over the household. So while the master of the house was away, the steward oversaw the household, made sure that everything was happening that needed to happen. To put it in the context of our day, make sure the dogs are fed, the plants are watered, et cetera, et cetera. He took care of everything in that day. And oftentimes they had household servants who worked under him. So this is the context here of a steward. But it says, who then is that faithful steward? So we've got to ask ourselves, who's he talking about here, this faithful steward? Well, the word faithful comes from the Greek word pistis, which means to trust or to believe. So this is a steward who is a trusting steward. This is a steward who trusts his master. This is a steward who believes in his master. And I would say to you here that this is a believer in Jesus Christ that he is talking about here, who is found watching, working, witnessing for the Lord. He's a faithful and wise steward. But notice what the promise is in verse 42. He says, who then is that faithful and wise steward? He's one who, when the master will eventually make him ruler over his household and give him his portion of food in due season. Look what it says in verse 43. Blessed is that servant whom his master will find so doing when he comes. So doing what? So found watching, ready when his master comes back. So handling his resources that he's given to him faithfully when he comes back. He's one who's going to have his waist girded. He's going to be focused on the work of the Lord. He's one who's going to have his lamp burning. He's going to let his light shine as a witness for the Lord. And he's one who's going to be found watching, waiting, ready to open the door any moment if the master were to come back in that exact moment. That's who this servant is. And in verse 43, Jesus says, blessed is that servant. Blessed is that servant. And then he says in verse 44, truly I say to you that he will make him ruler over all that he has. This is a picture. This faithful steward here is a picture of a true believer in Jesus Christ who's been given all the resources of our master to work with while he's away. We have been put here to manage his household, if you will, while he's away. Jesus ascended into heaven. He sits where? At the right hand of God the Father right now. He sent his Spirit here to live inside of us. He has empowered us to carry out his will on this earth while we're here on this earth. He's given us incredible resources to do that with. He's given us His Spirit to empower us. He's given us His Word to guide us and lead us and teach us what we're to do. He's given us all kinds of resources. He has given you and I a time to do things. You say, well, I don't have time. Maybe our priorities are out of order. We actually have a lot more time than we think. He's given us talents. You say, Pastor, I'm not talented at all. I don't have any gifts. According to Scripture, every single believer in Jesus Christ has been given at least one spiritual gift. And so you're all gifted in some way. So He's given us gifts. He's given us treasures. We're the most wealthy nation probably in the whole world, and He's given us all kinds of gifts and treasures. How are we using our time, our talents, and our treasures for Him? Are we being faithful as a steward of all that He has given us while we're here on this earth? The point I want you to see is He rewards faithfulness. We're blessed. We're given a position of leadership in His kingdom one day. We're all blessed by this. Pompeii was destroyed by the volcano eruption of Mount Vesuvius. If you watched the commercial, you know this, right? Y'all know what I'm talking about. Many people were buried in the ruins of that, and the city was missing for years. There was no sign of that, and then archaeologists rediscovered the city some 1,000 years later, and they found people in cellars. They found people in upper rooms. They found people out in the streets, just where the lava had came, and just right there on the spot took their life. But the story is told that they found one Roman sentinel, and he was found buried from the lava, died in his place, at his post, with his weapon still in his hand. When the lava came pouring down the mountain, he didn't run, he didn't hide. He stood his ground and he did what he had been called to do in that moment. He was faithful even in the midst of a life-threatening situation. The earth shook beneath him, the floods of ashes and hot cinders covered him, and he stood his post. And 1,000 years later, he was still found at his post, faithful to the bitter end. Wouldn't it be great if when the Lord comes, he finds us faithful to the bitter end? Faithful no matter what happens here on this earth to us. Faithful doing what God has called us to do. He's called us to do his work. Now, over the last several weeks, we've been talking about his work. Last week, being focused on the work, we talked about what is that work. A few weeks back, I preached from Ephesians chapter 4, 11 through 16. We talked about the fact that God had called some to be pastors and teachers for the equipping of the what? Of the saints. For the what? For the work of the ministry. Till we all come to the unity of the faith, to the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the stature of Jesus Christ. Went on to talk about in that passage how we're to all do our part, each part doing their part, using the gifts that God has given to each of us and the resources that he's given us. He's called us to do, all of us to do, the work of the ministry. And when we look around these United States of America that we live in, when we look around in High Point, North Carolina, and the other communities in this area, would you agree with me there is much ministry to be done? And God's called us to all do it, every one of us. We talked about how we're to let our light shine as a witness. We're to talk to people about Christ, but we're also to let our life be a ministry and a witness to other people. The Bible says elsewhere to be salt and light. We're to have an impact on the world that we live in. We're to be a good neighbor, a good co-worker, a good student, a good teacher, a good leader, good whatever calling God has given to you during the day as your job. To be good at that and be faithful and a Christ-loving, Christ-showing witness to everybody who sees our lives. There's much work to be done as we live out our lives for Jesus. And then in 2 Corinthians 5, 18 through 21, this is part of what God has called us to do while he waits. Listen to this. Now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ. Now let me just stop right there for a moment. God has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ. Why did we need reconciliation? Because our relationship with God was what? It was broken. Bible teaches us that we all sinned against God and our sin separates us from God. That relationship was broken apart by our sin. Sin drove a wedge between man and God, and man couldn't be with God in a relationship because of that sin. We were broken apart and separated. Jesus Christ came, died on the cross for our sins, was buried and raised again the third day so that we could be somehow reconciled back to our God in a relationship. And the moment you trusted Christ as Savior and Lord, you ceased to be enemies with God and became a friend of God. You ceased to be separated and became joined together in a relationship with our God through Jesus Christ and your relationship with Him. God reconciled us to Himself through Jesus Christ. Are you glad this morning that you are reconciled? But look what else it says. He has also given us the ministry of reconciliation. Now let me just say this. Don't misunderstand this phrase. You and I cannot reconcile anybody to God. You do not have the ability to save anybody. I don't have the ability to save anybody. I can't do anything to save a person. The only thing I can do is tell them about who can.
And the ministry of reconciliation is the ministry of you and I helping people see that they need Jesus and they need a relationship with Jesus. Listen to what else it says in verse 19. Here it is. He explains the ministry of reconciliation. That is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. We're to tell the word of reconciliation. Tell them how to be reconciled to God. Then he says in verse 20, now then, we are ambassadors for Christ. What does an ambassador do? He represents him. What does a steward do? He represents him. He manages his resource. As an ambassador, we work on behalf of Jesus. As though God, listen to this, as though God were pleading through us, we implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. The ministry of reconciliation is you and I talking to people and pleading with them. When's the last time we pleaded with somebody to come to Jesus? That we plead with somebody. What are we pleading? Be reconciled to God. You're in a broken relationship with God. Your sin has separated you from God. Be reconciled to God. Here's how you do that. Call on Jesus to be your Lord and your Savior. And somebody might say, well, Pastor, I don't know how to tell somebody. May I just say this honestly? If you know enough to be saved, you know enough to tell somebody how to be saved. If you know enough to be saved, you know enough to tell somebody how to be saved. It doesn't have to be precise words. You believe the power of the Holy Spirit can take your words and make them penetrate the heart of a person? Just share what Christ did for you. Plead with people to be reconciled to God. And then listen to this, verse 21. He says, for he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Let me very quickly hit on that. Here's why. Here's the motivation for us pleading with people to come to Christ. The motivation is it because Jesus became sin for you? On the cross, Jesus became your sin. God punished him instead of you. When you call on him by faith, rather than you being punished for your sin, he instead sees that he punished Jesus for you as he became your sin. And you became the righteousness of God in him. This is our motivation to do this. Are we faithful? God has called us to do his work. Are we being faithful? God has called us to do ministry. Are we being faithful? God has called us to use our time, our talents, and our resources. Seek first what? The kingdom. That's the main thing, is the kingdom. I want to tell you something. The United States, as much as I love it, is not the kingdom. It's not the main thing. It's not. Our jobs, we should do them as we're doing it for the glory of God, but it's not the main thing. The main thing is the kingdom. The main thing is eternal life. The main thing is what happens to us after we leave this place. All of us know that this life is over just like that. The Bible says it's like a vapor that you blow out on a frosty morning. That it's there for a second and it's gone. How quickly have our lives gone? Can I get an amen? Like yesterday I was driving that yellow Mustang down Myrtle Beach at the grandstand. What matters is eternal life. What are we doing with resources? Are we being faithful to the Lord? But there's a second truth I want you to see, and that is this. Unfaithfulness is costly. Unfaithfulness is costly. So look what it says in verse 45. But if that servant says in his heart, my master is delaying his coming. So he's got no sense of urgency. He thinks he's got plenty of time. He's delaying his coming. And he begins to beat the male and female servants and to eat and drink and be drunk. In other words, he's using the servants for his own pleasure. He's doing things for his own pleasure. He's just living it up. He's enjoying his sin while he can, thinking that the master's not going to come back anytime soon. That's the picture we have here. Verse 46 says, The master of that servant will come on a day when he's not looking for him, at an hour when he's not aware, and will cut him in two and appoint his portion with the unbelievers. Now, I got to take a little time to unpack this, and I need you to really follow closely with me to understand the passage, because scholars debate this passage about who are these servants. Scholars debate, are these servants believers, all of them? Are they unbelievers? Is the unfaithful servant just a believer who's not been faithful in what he's doing? Is that what he's talking about? So let's look at this a little closer. There are some who believe that this unfaithful servant in verse 45 and 46 is a believer who's just not doing what he's supposed to do. So let's look at that a little closer. Look in the verse 46. He will cut him in two. So they say, if they think that this is a believer, they think that cut in two is just separate, and that somehow God's going to separate the really faithful believers over here and the unfaithful believers he's going to discipline in some kind of way, and that's what cut them in two means. The only problem I have with that is at the end of verse 46, he says, and appoint his portion with the what? With the unbelievers. It's hard for me to grasp how that is speaking of a servant who is a believer when it says that he's going to throw him in with the unbelievers. Well, also, we interpret Scripture with Scripture. And so look at Matthew chapter 24 and verse 48. And here we have the faithful servant and the unfaithful servant again. In verse 48, Matthew, rather than call him unfaithful, Matthew says, but if that evil servant. If that evil servant, that seems to describe an unbeliever. But if we're still not convinced, this is my heartfelt opinion. He says in verse 51, he will cut him in two and appoint his portion with the hypocrites. The hypocrite's a phony. Okay? And then he says, if we're still not sure, there shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. What does that always describe in Scripture? Hell. So I believe when we look at all that together, that the unfaithful servant back over in Luke 12 is an unbeliever, but he professed to be a believer. It's a person who claimed that he loved his master, claimed that he was a believer, but in reality proved himself not to be, and at the judgment will end up being cast aside with all the other unbelievers, where there will be gnashing of teeth. So I believe that's what he's speaking of. Then go to verse 47. And then it says, and that servant who knew his master's will and did not prepare himself or do according to his will be beaten with many stripes, but he who did not know yet committed things deserving of stripes will be beaten with a few, because to whom much is given, much is required. So here we have that servant who knew his master's will. And that servant who didn't know, but did things deserving of punishment, gets less stripes than the other one. There's degrees of punishment in verse 47 and 48. The question again arises, who are these servants? Is this an unfaithful servant who is an unbeliever? And one of these unbelievers is a person who knew God's will but didn't do it, and he's going to get a more severe punishment in hell. And this other servant is an unbeliever who didn't know anything and is going to get less punishment in hell. Some scholars believe, and it may be, that there are degrees of punishment in hell. It may very well be. A lot of people see that these two are unfaithful servants, unbelievers, who get different degrees of punishment in hell. But what is another option here? Another option is that this is a third and a fourth servant. The first servant is a faithful servant who's a true believer, found doing his master's will when he comes back. The second servant is an unfaithful servant who professed Christ but is not a true believer, didn't do what his master told him to do, and was cast into hell with the unbelievers. And then in verse 47, there's a third servant, that servant who knew his master's will, who's a believer and knew Scripture, knew what to do, but didn't do it. Less punishment at the judgment seat of Christ, where believers are judged for what we did with our time, our talents, and our treasures. And then verse 48, but he who did not know might be a believer who just never really grew very much and didn't know what to do, and they're punished at the judgment seat of Christ, and their punishment is that they get less punishment because they didn't know. All right? So I land here. It could be that there are degrees of punishment in hell, and these are unbelievers. But I believe you've got the faithful servant who's a believer who's faithful. You got the unfaithful servant who is a false believer. And then you got two other believing servants, one who knew what to do and didn't, who gets less reward and more punishment. Their works are burned up at the judgment seat of Christ because they knew what to do and didn't. And then you got a fourth one who's a believer who didn't even know what to do. Maybe a brand new Christian, he died the next day, ends up at the judgment seat of Christ. He didn't know any better, didn't know what to do. Okay? All of that to be said now that you're thoroughly confused, along with all scholars throughout history. What's the main thing we do know? All right, I can't be positive which it's talking about here, but here's what I know. The servant in verse 47 and the servant in verse 48, they didn't do what God wanted them to do, and there was some type of judgment for it. It was costly. The unfaithful servant in verse 46, it was costly. Unfaithfulness is costly. And that much we know absolutely for certain. Listen, think about unfaithfulness in the Bible. One great example of unfaithfulness in Scripture was Moses. Was Moses a God-fearing man? Would we say Moses was a great leader and did mostly what God wanted him to do? Yes. But when God said, Moses, speak to this rock and water will flow out of it. Did Moses speak to the rock? What did he do? He struck it instead. Did he get water? But what happened as a result? He did not get to go into the promised land. Now, that doesn't mean Moses is an unbeliever, but he didn't get to go in and enjoy all the blessings of the land that was promised to him and experience that. It was costly for him. Our unfaithfulness is costly. None more costly than the one who doesn't really know Jesus. We live in a day where people don't want to talk about hell, don't want to talk about the reality of hell. They don't want preachers and pastors to talk about hell. But may I just tell you that Jesus talked about hell quite a bit. The Bible talks about hell quite a bit. And any pastor, teacher that's not willing to talk about hell is not really willing to preach the whole counsel of God. God has called us to read His Word. There is a real place called hell, where there's punishment. It's not annihilation. It's not like you die and you're just punished one time and annihilated. The Bible speaks of it as being a place of everlasting punishment, everlasting separation from God, being apart from Him. Remember this, that everybody who ends up in hell one day will spend eternity separated from God after knowing that Jesus really is who He said He was, wishing that they had made a different decision in this life. It's costly because everyone who doesn't know Jesus, even if you professed it, but deep down you know you're not really His, it's costly because you end up eternally separated from God in a place of torment. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him would have not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. God didn't come. He didn't send Jesus down here to condemn everybody to hell. He came here to save people from going to hell. He who believes in him, listen to this, is not condemned. But he who does not believe is condemned already. Why? Because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And in John 3:36, it says, he who believes in the Son has everlasting life, and he who does not believe the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him. We live in a world today that doesn't like to talk about the wrath of God, because how could God be a loving God and still have wrath? But in the very passage where the most quoted verse of Scripture, John 3:16, says God so loved the world, in the same passage, in the same verses, it says that he also condemns those who don't believe. In the same passage, it talks about his wrath. And I would say to you and everybody watching today and in the days ahead, you will never truly understand the love of God until you understand the wrath of God. Until we understand what we deserve, which is to be separated from God forever, we will never truly understand how much God loved us. Until we understand that we deserve to be separated from God, we will never understand the love of God that Christ was separated for us on the cross. Yes, God loves you. Yes, God loves everybody. But his love is demonstrated in what he did to save us from our sins in sending Jesus to the cross. And so what do you and I do? We plead with people. The Bible says this in 2 Corinthians 6:2. In an acceptable time I have heard you, and in the day of salvation I have helped you. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. Now is the day of salvation. We don't know that there will be a later time for salvation. We don't know that when we get home this afternoon, we'll have another opportunity. Now, right now, is the time of salvation. If you don't know Jesus as your Lord and your Savior, the only way that you can be prepared when he comes back is to make him your Lord and your Savior today. Are you ready? Church family, if you're a born-again believer in Jesus Christ, are you ready to be found faithful when he comes back? Will you pray with me? With every head bowed and every eye closed, the most important question I've asked you today is, are you sure that you're saved? Are you sure that you're ready when he comes back, that you've trusted Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord? We've talked about over the last couple of weeks that on Sunday morning and Wednesday night that faith without works is dead. Doesn't mean we work our way to be saved, but we're saved by grace. But if you're saved, there's some works. There's a change in your life. Are you carrying out the will of the Father? Don't be found unfaithful as an unbeliever when he comes back. If that's you, if you know deep down in your heart you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, today is the day. Don't wait another moment. Don't wait another day. You don't know that you have one. Pastor Josh and I will be down at the front when we stand to sing in just a second. If that's you and you're in the room, you come and tell us, today I want to pray to receive Christ as my Savior and Lord. Come down here and talk to us. If there's somebody you say, well, Pastor, everybody thinks I'm saved, but I'm really not. Listen, the only one that matters is God and what he knows and what you know. You come and say, everybody thinks I'm saved, but I don't think I am. It's okay if everybody thought you were saved. Everybody will celebrate that you're saved today if you trust him. You come. If you're watching online and this is you, reach out to us, contact us. Call the church office, email us, talk to one of us, and let us walk you through what it means to pray to receive Christ. But listen, you can pray and call on him right now in your living room, in your den, your kitchen, wherever you're watching this. You can call on him right now to be your Lord and Savior. You don't have to have a pastor present. I'm not your priest. Jesus is your high priest. You call on him where you are, and then reach out to us and tell us what you did so we can follow up with you on that. and tell you what's next. But all across the room and everybody watching, what are we doing while we wait as believers? How will He find us? What are you doing with your time, your talents, and your treasures? Are you being faithful to what He's called you to? And if not, ask the Holy Spirit to show you areas of improvement in that and trust that He will, and move forward to a new day faithfully serving Him. Father, move in the hearts of all of these Your people. Change us and mold us by Your word. Save people who need to be saved, Lord. And challenge all of us as believers to focus more on what You've called us to do, because that's what matters most. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Standing together as we sing, You Come as God is leading you this morning. All of those who are going on the Montana mission trip, if you would come down here to the front and stand facing the congregation. As they're doing that, let me just say this morning. Whenever we come to a passage where it's talking about hell and the wrath of God, walk away focusing on the love of God and what He did for you. And today is a day for you as a believer to just celebrate how God has changed you and saved you from your sin. Be sure and do that the rest of this day. So this group of folks that you see here, and I know there are probably a couple that are not with us, so two others that are part of the team, they are going to help New Day Fellowship in St. Regis, Montana, where they're constructing a 2,000-square-foot parsonage. And the congregation there is one of the very few evangelical churches along the I-90 corridor between Missoula and Idaho border. And the housing in that area is very sparse and extremely expensive. And there's no way they could pay the pastor enough to support him in that area. And so building this parsonage is a huge blessing to that church as it tries to reach people for Christ. And this team will be going and helping do that. Working, so we want to pray for their safety, for their protection, for them in every single way. And then also, as part of that, they're taking a cross with them. And this is a tradition here. I don't know how long this tradition's been going on, but these crosses are for them to share that with somebody as they're there. Here's what I want us to pray. I want us to pray for a perfect person, just that right person for them to share this cross with. But let's don't just limit it to this one cross. And let's pray for lots and lots of conversations about Jesus as they do go and do this work for the Lord. Here's what I'm going to ask you to do. Again, I don't know how y'all have done this in the past, but this is how we're going to do it today, all right? So I'm going to ask if some of the deacons, if you're a deacon, if you would come down and lay hands on them. If you're uncomfortable doing that, stand close to them will be fine. But come down, gather around them. And then congregation, any family and friends or just a church member in general or visitor, whoever, if you want to join down here, you're welcome to do that, to gather around them. But we're going to close in prayer, and this will conclude our service today. We commission them on the part of our church family and on the part of the Lord to go out. We're sending them out, representing us, but representing Jesus as ambassadors, as stewards of what God's given to them. Will you pray with me? Father in heaven, God, we come to you, and Lord, we thank you that somebody told us that we needed to be reconciled to you through Jesus. Thank you for that person or many persons who told us that, Lord, and gave us that good news. We thank you, God, that you've called us to do your work. And part of that work, Lord, is planting churches all over the world where we can't go and where there are few. God, we know that you've especially been helping out, starting churches, Lord, in Montana, a region that's very lost. I thank you for this sweet church that you've planted there, for the pastor that you have brought in to pastor that church, for the congregation that will be there. And I thank you, God, that you're raising up believers from churches all across the world to come and help build this parsonage so that a pastor can live there and shepherd that flock and they can make disciples of their surrounding area. God, I pray that you would use each and every one of these people that are a part of this team. I pray that you would bless them with good health prior to the trip, good health on the trip and as they return. I pray that you would protect them as they fly out, as they drive, as they work on the job. I pray that, Lord, you would give them great comfort and strength each day to do the work that you've called them to do. And I pray, oh God, not only for that one special conversation using this cross, Lord, but for multiple conversations with people to share the good news of Jesus Christ with others, pleading with them, be reconciled to God. God, now we commit them to you and to the work that you've called them to, specifically in Montana. And we pray that great things will be done in the name of Jesus. We pray all this in Jesus' holy name. Amen.